They see all of us, or will they see nothing?
No, they will
No,
see.
no.
It's
They will see. Okay, Shrikumar, how are you?
I'm fine. How are you,
Yeah,
Rajiv?
good, good. Absolutely fine. So they will, I think, once we start broadcasting it, they will see all of us.
Okay.
So we are just waiting for the secretary to join, and once he joins, then we will start. Then we'll open it to all.
Okay, thank you.
Sir, we are live on YouTube now.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Ranjan, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon, sir.
Good afternoon.
Should we start?
Yeah, please.
So, with your permission, we'll start here.
So, welcome to this TVD event. I think ICC is extremely happy that seaweed sector is now receiving due attention, and Prime Minister Modi has identified the sector as a major growth priority going ahead, because the seaweed sector has huge impact on the population living around the coast, and ICC has been actively working on this for the last 3 years. So to begin with, I would request Mr. Vikash Agarwal, Senior Vice President of ICC, to please deliver the formal welcome address. Mr. Agarwal.
On behalf of ICC, I would like to extend a very warm welcome to Mr. Rajiv Ranjan, Honorable Secretary, Dr. G.S. Sambiran, Director of Fisheries, Government of Tamil Nadu, Dr. Jay Balaji, Joint Secretary, Marine Fisheries, Department of Fisheries, Government of India, and Industrial Research of CSMCRI. Ladies and gentlemen, let me begin by thanking our Prime Minister, Sri Narendra Modi ji, for identifying seaweed as a future growth sector. 40 crores to boost the cultivation of seaweed in the coastal states. Seaweed, with its rising global demand, has many benefits. With its high nutritional value, low investment, high returns, employment generating capacities, eco-friendliness, and abundance of harvestable area. The only Indian chamber to capture this opportunity by taking several initiatives in the seaweed sector, which include 3 international conferences and expos with CSIR and CSIR in the past 3 years. Our conferences have engaged with participants from India and 11 other countries, including US, UK, and France. And the event could mobilize over 100 B2B meetings and around 60 crores worth of expression of interest in Tamil Nadu alone. And while working, we realized there are certain areas which need immediate attention for sector development. And addressing these concerns, I would like to offer the following initiatives which I see. For India. Second, setting up a sector skill council for organizing training programs. Thirdly, working closely with the industries, the institutions, and the potential investors for the right technology and technical tie-ups. Mr. Ranjan, as a partner in the government Seaweed Vision 2025, I also provide a full-time secretariat for a task force to work with states, industry, and institutions reporting to the Department of Fisheries, Government of India. And we are confident we will find the right support from the business fraternity and in a short time contribute to the Indian economy in the ways we all be proud of. With these words, I would request Dr. S. Kannan to deliver the keynote address. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. Dr. Rajiv Ranjan, Honorable Secretary, Department of Fisheries, Government of India. Dr. Balaji, Joint Secretary, Department of Fisheries, Government of India. Mr. Vikash Agarwal, Senior Vice President, Indian Chamber of Commerce. Dr. Shamiran, Directorate of Fisheries, Government of Tamil Nadu. And all the delegates and presenters across the world, and the participants, the delegates, the participants who are witnessing the event in multiple various platforms. I know that for sure that we are also having in a WebEx platform and also in a YouTube platform. And all the delegates, a warm good afternoon from the Indian side of it. Of course, I mean, different time zones, different positions at this point of time. And I am very happy that along with the Indian Chamber of Commerce, CSIR Central Salt and Marine Chemicals Research Institute, a constituent laboratory of Council of Scientific and Industrial Research, is organizing this India Seaweed Electronic Forum. Okay, I mean, we have been discussing this on last 3 occasions in a physical manner. That started the first event sometime in Bombay in 2018 or 17, and then we conducted an event the year after, and in 2020 was a kind of a stellar event that we had it in NIOT Chennai, and this is probably a 4th in the series that we have been having this a joint event along with the ICC. I express my deep sincere thanks and regards to Indian Chamber of Commerce for organizing jointly organizing this. I just wanted to give in my address, for any domain to be successful, you need largely 4 quadrants. The 4 quadrants are, you need to have a kind of an impacting research, and you should have a kind of a government departments, especially those projects which are having a kind of a socio-economic implications. Government departments willingness for taking up the projects and support in terms of policies through ministries and government bodies. And of course, needless to say, the industry who can basically translate these research through the interventions of the policies and the support of government into a kind of a reality. These four quadrants, if they are in place perfectly, I think any industry, in my opinion, is sustainable. And I'm very happy to say that these four quadrants are having the best of its best times in 2020. I'm very, very glad that all of us are on the same page. The interest shown by the Department of Fisheries, they had series of meetings with several of our R&D institutions, with stakeholders, with the industry list, with policymakers, several of this. And of course, I mean, the interest shown by the government departments, of course, the interest which was shown by government of Tamil Nadu is always been a kind of a way ahead in terms of their forthright cooperation for taking projects, civil related projects in higher level. And that's our main and also several industries have sprung up in the last 2 decades. Of course, as Vikash was pointing it out, we are only in the tip of the iceberg. We have too many things to discover, and we had to grow very significantly. And I'm telling you, I mean, the one of the things which I find there has been a kind of a significant push by the industry also for the expansion. And in the expansion, cultivation is going to be one of the biggest factor that would be contributing it. And this particular forum would address how the cultivation prospects would be basically managed in the country like India. So I think you cannot generalize these things. We have to have a kind of a specifics, especially in the Indian context. And I'm very happy to say that there are several entrepreneurs are evincing interest. And entrepreneurs are from different section of the society. People who are working in colleges, people who are working in multinational companies, people who are working in institutions. Many of them are willing to explore a kind of entrepreneurial exploration of CVs as a kind of an opportunity to jump on. That's probably a very, very important direction that this domain is growing. And in my address, I just don't want to touch on the policies and governmental interactions, governmental measures, governmental action plan, because this is, I'm sure that my the chief guests as well as the speakers on this the inaugural forum would be certainly covering that. As an R&D institute, what would be the kind of a challenges and what should be the way forward in terms of the R&D is something which is what I just thought of mentioning it in the after giving a kind of a broader overview, wanted to give this kind of a broader picture. This is one important thing. I think the seaweed cultivation to really happen, we need to have a kind of a very good clarity on the cultivation prospects across the country. Unfortunately, as on date, these prospects are not so clearly visible. Okay, and we really do not have a kind of a clear-cut understanding what sites are suitable for cultivation across the country and what kind of a species that should be grown, what kind of a balance and what kind of an ecosystem that should be basically put in place. This is something which is very, very important for all these states and the union territories to grow. So this is one of the most important area that R&D should be basically focused on that direction. The other important thing is, one of the critical thing which is having a kind of a difficulty was seed material. We have to find through R&D means, ways and means of creating a kind of a having the seed material available that could be basically given at any given point of time, especially after the monsoon or after the any kind of a natural calamity. Because this particular domain, since we are basically growing in sea, Okay, there are certain natural calamities, it is vulnerable. And that poses another opportunity for us. Can we basically, what do you call, do this seaweed cultivation without having any kind of an environmental implication? That should be the area that R&D research should be basically focused on to have a kind of a greater impact in the years to come. And of course, there is another most important thing is on the downstream processing of seaweeds into value-added products. This is a kind of a area where, I mean, there is a significant amount of done. This institute has carried out over the last 15, 20 years. But still, when you are really growing into a kind of an industry 4.0 or industry energy less intensive, industry economic, environmentally friendly process, industry with a lesser water footprint, these are some of the important things where, I mean, the downstream processing would have a kind of a stellar role played by the R&D institutions. Can I basically reduce the water amount of water needed for producing a one ton of agar? Can I basically make a kappa, I mean, a carrageenan of a different variance by tweaking the process variable? Can I make a kind of a different formulations suitable for biostimulant formulation, suitable for the Indian agricultural lands, very diverse in agricultural lands? These are some of the great areas where R&D would be basically contributing significantly in the years to come. Needless to say, as it was mentioned in the initial remarks, edible sector is a great sector for seaweeds to grow, and we are very, very infancy in that sector. In fact, I mean, we are yet to be born, I would say. We're not even in an infant, okay? So we have to be basically contributing significantly on the edible seaweed sector, and the nutraceutical potential, the pharmaceutical potential, the food potential, the feed potential of seaweeds are phenomenal, which I'm sure that the efforts laid by the institutions would make a kind of a great impact. And I am very pleased to say that this kind of efforts have to be done in a kind of a great collaboration among the institutions also. And many institutions have to work together for realizing this dream. So there have been a kind of a targets that have been set in a kind of a shorter time frame, which India has never witnessed before. For these to be realized, there is a significant amount of collaboration in all the four quadrants are necessary for it to be realizable. I also wanted to basically say R&D should also be important in terms of quality assurance, in terms of quality of the products that are coming out from the seaweeds, in terms of ascertaining the both in the domestic segment as well as on the import segment or in the export segments. Needs to be basically where the R&D would play a kind of a great important role. And I'm sure if you really see a UN Sustainable Development Goals, seaweed cultivation and processing would contribute 10 out of that 17 Sustainable Development Goals. This clearly speaks of how much impact this particular domain can contribute. And I firmly believe this decade, 2020 to 2030, would be a kind of a seaweed growth decade that India would be witnessing. And I'm sure that, I mean, when we are discussing this kind of efforts in 2030, we would have been a kind of a very good exponential curve on this domain. We are currently a kind of a few tens of millions of dollars, and I'm sure this domain would go into hundreds of millions of dollars. With this, I just wanted to, I mean, I'm sure that the organization like CSIR has been supporting on this seaweed in a variety of ways. In fact, we have been having a kind of a consistent seaweed missions, and there have been a kind of a phenomenal support from government departments and also from departments like National Fisheries Development Board for several of the projects, several of the technologies that could be basically made into possibility that are really been catered to the industries and which basically makes this forum to be happening. And I sincerely wish all the best for all the forum participation. And I'm sure that at the end of the participation, we would be drawing a kind of a very logical conclusions and way forward to realize the dream of our Honorable Prime Minister also as a field of its own. And I just wanted hundreds of startups by the end of 2030 to be working on this series. With this, I sincerely thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity to share the remarks on behalf of CSER CSMCRI. Thank you.
Dr. Kannan, thank you. I think now we are all keen to listen to our chief guest. So may I request Dr. Rajiv Ranjan to please address us.
Thank you, Dr. Singh. It's very good that we are having this meeting today. On the back of the three consult international CVID summits that you had. So though we are not doing it physically this time, but we are in the COVID scenario, which you have suggested in the post-COVID current scenario, is where it forces us to do the remote method of addressing each other. So under these difficult times, we are making the best of it, and I'm happy that you're organizing it. I have a presentation which is there. So if it has been, we have shared it with you. If you are launching it from there, otherwise, if you want, I can do it from here. If it is,
no, I think we can do it. Shuman, can we do it?
Yes, sir. Let me start it.
Yeah. Okay, now I will just, in the next few slides, take you in the some general points about how the fishery sector has been doing and why the government is very keen to promote seaweed cultivation in a big way. So to give that perspective, I will like to begin by saying that the Indian fishery sector, which has been doing very well, and it is one of the sunrise sectors. And if you look at the last 5 years, it has shown very impressive growths. Almost 11% average annual growth rate has been exhibited in the last 5 years. In terms of the fish production, we are growing close to 8% in the last 5 years. And in terms of the exports also, in value terms, it's almost close to 10% in the last 5 years. So this itself shows that in the agriculture and allied sector, where the growth rates are not very easy, we have been doing very well. So fisheries is a sunrise sector. And in that, we would like now seaweed to come in and play a stellar role. In terms of the contribution to the national GVA, it is 1.24%, and the contribution to the agriculture GVA is 7.28%. So the fisheries department has been newly created, because the contribution to the whole growth and in terms of employment, it has been recognized. An independent department of fisheries has been created. The Honorable Prime Minister is putting a lot of stress on the growth of this sector. And he's been very particular, and he has given us direction several times to promote the seaweed industry. In fact, in his role when he was the chief minister in Gujarat also, he has been mentioning about the importance of seaweed, and that is how CSMCRI has been already working, and they have interacted. So if you look at it, this has been also mentioned in the budget. And so at the Government of India level, there's a clear recognition that we should promote in a big way. A ministry was also created in June 2019. So at the level of Government of India, now Fisheries Department is one of those departments which is spearheading the growth in fisheries. And also because we are doing well at global level also. Today, in terms of global share, we have a 7.73% share in fish production. India is the second largest aquaculture producer and the fourth largest seafood exporter. So if you look at it in terms of exports, we are currently doing about 46,600 crores, and we have a target to achieve 1 lakh crores in the next 5 years. At the back of the mind, we should keep in that fish is a very affordable animal source of protein and nutrition, and it supports large number of people in terms of their income and livelihood. Almost 2.8 crore people fish are dependent on this in this sector. So from that, if we look at it, if we go to the next slide, you see the new scheme which has been launched. I just thought I'll touch upon it, the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. This has been launched in May, and as of now, we have already implemented it across the country. We already have 26 states now who have finalized their proposals, and we have sanctioned, in fact, money for 8 states already, covering almost 1,400 crores. So if you look at it in terms of quickly, to the objectives have been to harness the fisheries potential in a sustainable, responsible, inclusive, and equitable manner. And if you look at it in terms of diversification, seaweed comes also as one of the areas where we need to diversify. We are just scratching the surface as far as seaweed is concerned, and that is why we would like to have a more effective utilization of land and water, and also modernized and strengthened the entire value chain by doing adequate investments in post-harvest management and quality improvement. Basically, the idea is to double the fishers and fish farmer incomes and create a lot of employment. We are looking at 55 lakh employment generation in the next 5 years through this sector. So basically, in addition to a robust fisheries management and regulatory framework, we're also looking at social, physical, and economic security for fishers and fish farmers. And in this case, women particularly, because seaweed cultivation and processing can and is involving large number of women. The total investments is of the order of more than 20,000 crores. And that is what we are looking at through the Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana. Next slide, please. These are the key targets. I just wanted to summarize, because some of you who are not aware of all that, the details of PMSY, to look at it, we are looking at a very ambitious fish production target of 220 lakh tons, which means a growth rate of 9%, which is quite achievable because already we are growing at about 8%. So, and the aquaculture productivity, that's a key factor, because India being so diverse and so large, there are areas and pockets where the productivity is still quite low. They will like to improve that. So even if we reach average of 5 tons per hectare, which again is not much, there are large number of progressive farmers who are already much, much ahead. But we are looking at the average, and we would like to do that. Fisheries exports I mentioned already, and we have a very detailed strategy for how we'll reach into that. Post-harvest losses are high at the present level of almost 25%. We want to reduce to 10%. Employment generation, I mentioned, we are going to make it at least 55 lakhs, and there are more in terms of the value chain. And domestic fish consumption, that is something which we are lagging behind in the country. So to have more, you know, because malnutrition, Honorable Prime Minister has mentioned in his Mann Ki Baat last Sunday, that in September, we should use it as to concentrate attraction on the nutrition aspect of looking at it, how we can look at malnutrition as an issue for the country, because there are pockets of India where there are issues. So that is why fish is very ideally suited for doing that. And we wanted to target a 12 kg per person per annum. This is what the general thing is. Next slide, please. Now coming to seaweed, you see the cultivation, processing, marketing, that's what we are touching today in our seminar. And if you look at it in terms of the global market, we have a $12 billion kind of a market, but we are nowhere. And that is why, if you see, in 2020, we are looking at quantity in tons about 25,000 tons. But these numbers are also not very exact, because we have not looked at it. By some definition, it should be around 50, 55, 60,000. But these numbers have to be worked at to finalize them. But what we have in mind is clear. In 2025, we should aim at almost 10 to 11 lakh tons of production. And for doing that, we need to look at huge investments which we have provided in PMSY. We have 640 crores lined up for that, and it will help in economic empowerment of coastal women. Risks are very low in this. There are issues which we just heard the director tell us, and we should be looking at it in terms of there are always issues which we will discuss as we go along. So of the varieties of CVs which are there, we need to, if you look at global aquaculture production, and I'll cover that in the next few slides, but we are very, very negligible. So what we need to do is to encourage more self-help group of women, fisher women in coastal areas, through rafts and tube nets, more seed banks and value addition. This is what we like to do. Next, please. If you look at global scenario, again, you will notice India is nowhere, for the reason that 99.51% is in Asia, and there, again, few countries dominate, China and Indonesia primarily, but other Asian countries also have some. So India is 0.02%, that's all. So we need to now see that we need to go higher and at least come to about 5%, which is what we should be looking at. So this is where we need to do. And this also is possible because if you look at it, Indonesia, for example, it is only that last 15 to 20 years, they have shown the kind of results and reached that level. So it is possible to do that. And the classic case of Indonesia is there for us to go into. If these numbers are there, they have tripled their production in the last 10 to 15 years. And you know, all that is possible. So we can look at it. And we have done extensive consultations. Last week itself, on 24th of last month, we had done a national extensive consultation. I'll talk about it also. And we have come with some numbers and clear strategy. I'll just dwell on it a little bit. And maybe later I'll ask my colleague, Dr. Balaji, who's there, who's spearheading this whole work. And he will go into details and explain much of what we are doing. Next slide, please. In terms of global scenario, in terms of production, you see the farm seaweed is 97.1%. So wild collected are not so much. And if you look at again, in terms of it is the East and Southeast Asia, with China being the largest producer. And again, if you look at it, Capophagus is the bigger species in Indonesia. And if I was mentioning that from an output of less than 4 million tons in 2010, now it became 11 million tons in 15-16, and you know that is how they keep growing. And in our case, we need to, if you look at total market value, again, these numbers are not very definitive, but they're very small compared to what our potential is. So these numbers also we need to finalize and look at it by getting into more in details. So basically the idea is that in the world scenario, we don't have a presence, and that is why we need to work on various fronts to make that happen. Next slide, please. Here I'd like to now mention about the institutions, the technical scientific institutions, which have done yeoman's work in this area. And because of that, a lot of technology has been developed. But our challenge is to now use that and do on a commercial scale, a much bigger scale, to make it really noticeable at the world stage. The primary, in fact, role has been played by CSIR institution, CSMCRI, and the director, we had the pleasure of listening. And they have been working on it on several decades. They have done very good work on Capophagus. And we need to also, you know, see that how what they have developed seed and transferred to Tamil Nadu and Gujarat. And we have in the inaugural session, the Director of Fisheries from Tamil Nadu, Dr. Samiran, who would also tell us about the important role Tamil Nadu has played in nurturing seaweed cultivation. And now our challenge is to go to the next level. So taking those experiences on board, we have got the confidence that we can plan for a much bigger scale. if you look at that, CSR, CSM, CRI has done so much work in Brazil area also, and transfer of technology to the field and industry. And that is why today industry has also come up. And in addition to CSM, CRI, we have the ICR Institute, the CMFRI in Cochin. They have the Central Marine Fisheries Research Institute. They have also worked on agar yielding seaweeds of Brazil area. And they have again developed standardized culture techniques, and they have looked at nutraceuticals. In fact, this was appreciated by the Honorable Prime Minister when the DG's ICR had done a presentation on 4th of July. And he specifically mentioned again that seaweed is something which we should be putting much more effort into. Similarly, we have Delhi University Department of Botany, Dr. Sahu, working on this, and we have many other eminent scientists. NIOT, which was hosting, was co-host of the third International Seaweed Expo in Chennai last year, in January. Again, as I can see that there are many, they have a very important role to map the areas, because they have done pilot project in cultivation in the coast of Andamans and Nicobar. And in addition to Tamil Nadu, Gujarat, we are looking at Andamans and the other areas where there is potential, and especially Lakshadweep and other states, marine states, where they can be taken up, which we'll cover as we go by. Next slide, please. So as a if you look at it in terms of the roadmap, this partly came out also of our consultation, and I thought I'd share with you the larger picture in terms of what kind of work is being planned. If you look at it, this is for the next 5 years, the kind of work. So initially in 2020, we are looking at very ambitious target of 1.68 lakh tons of cultivation. So initially it will involve mapping of the areas, establishing seed banks, working through collectivization of groups, farmer groups, women especially, through the self-help groups, the or farmers, producer organization. We will look at coastal seaweed villages helping us. It can be also done through import of high yielding variety. This is one issue which the existing one, the yields have come down and the vigor has been lost in whatever we have been. So we need to also look at that. And this was one thing which we can do. Area expansion requires to be done. Training and capacity building is required throughout the period. R&D, as I mentioned, the institutes, and then processing, value addition. It can be used in biofertilizer, nutraceutical, more of market creation, branding. And with this, we also hopefully would like to get into exports as we go along. So this is the broad area of what we are doing. The next slide, in fact, talks a little bit about of the various. Next slide, please, we just show that what are the areas, the phycocolloidals, the other niche products, they can be used in terms of very high value, products. Right now, India imports quite a lot of these. For example, in caprophagus, if you look at it in refined carrageenan, we are importing almost 2,000 metric ton. We produce almost about 300 metric ton, and the global market is 50,000 metric ton. Similarly, in agar and agarose out of glacial area, there again the market size is huge. The world market is over 50,000 metric tons, which are very important, especially for bacteriological and pharma grade. And we only do about 400 metric tons, and we import 2,000 metric tons. So if you look at the slogan given by Honorable Prime Minister of Atmanirbhar Bharat, there again, if we just try to get here production and use it here, we will be able to substitute a lot of these high value that we are trying to get out of it. And there are large products which can come out of it. Next, please. This is the state wise, because we involve the state. Ultimately, the work has to be done at the state level, and Gujarat, Tamil Nadu are already taking the lead. And we are asking the other states to also come on board. So we have now discussed, and we have tried to look at a incremental production target. And this is how we would like the large areas to come get involved. And this is where we need to very quickly see that new areas which were not taken up will also have to be brought in under this. That's why huge amount of work is required to get many stakeholders on board quickly and get onto cultivation in large area. Next, please. in terms of the PMSY key activities, so as you said that we have a target for investments, and that will come into many areas, whether they are seaweed cultivation or seed banks for quality, or we are looking at marketing or marketing infrastructure. All this will be covered up, and we are looking at even entrepreneurship models for taking it up. So this is how we are now looking at key activities and key areas through which we can promote. And we have discussed with, in fact, on the 24th August, when we had the national consultation, we involved large number of people from the industry, and we involved large number of stakeholders who also gave us very good feedback. And based on that, we have refined it even further. The next slide, please. In terms of the key strategies, so we have to look at quality seed, because that is a big area. National network of seed banks and nurseries have to be established. And we need to also do more of seaweed parks in areas which are possible, like in Tamil Nadu or Gujarat. Strong institutional framework are needed, so right up to the from coastal village to upwards, for whether it's for marketing support. Convergence is very important, and we will show you in the next slide of how many other ministries are involved, and that is one of the issues in terms of what kind of convergence requirements are there. We obviously have to converge with rural development to look at MNREGA or the national the livelihood mission to integrate with that. We need to also integrate with RKVY, the KCC, the Agriculture and Farmer Welfare Ministry, the ICAR for their technology backup and handholding, the MSME, the shipping for coastal development, Sagarmala, Ministry of Textiles, because fabrics is one possibility of usage, export incentives through the commerce. So large number of industries are required to be on board. Next, please. This is what courtesy government of Tamil Nadu, they have worked out the value chain. And because Dr. Samiran is there, he will be able to cover more of it. So I will not get into details of this. Maybe I would leave that the later part of the, I'll quickly now rush through the remaining slides. And just to give you a flavor of, next slide, please. The value chain, again, if you see in terms of we can do, if we just do more processing, we can look at 500 fishermen, just use the seaweed further processing and make sap, and then we can take up huge, and we can do it in seaweed clusters of 10 villages. So this is one approach that we will be looking at it, and my colleague Dr. Balaji will be covering more of this. The next slide is again taken from the CSM CRI in terms of what is it. Yeah, if you can go progress it, it will show what is the current stage. Next please. Yeah, you can just see this is our right side transition is what we are looking at it. And this is what in the next 5 years we need to cover them all. And that is what we are now trying to do at a commercial scale. This is what our plan is. And that is why more of such consultation that we are having today, more of such discussions, which will broad base our you know, support base in terms of interest generation and having different roles to take it up. Next slide, please. The next slide, next, again, this will be, they have covered a bit of it. The director, Dr. Kannan mentioned, and I will not go into that. Next, please. This is again an area where large new area, the edible seaweeds, we are not touching that. That itself more than 5 billion. We can be using at the seaweed sap as animal food and feed for poultry and cattle. So there is good possibilities of using all this. Large scale opportunity in biofuels, biopolymer, bio-based chemicals. So, but many of them are in the laboratory stage. Many of them are at various stages of development. So we have to take it from the pilot and make it commercial on a large scale. That is one challenge. But at the same time, while we are looking at production in a big way, we also have to look at market development and also have to tie up with the industries. And that is why at the same time, we have to engage with all kinds of stakeholders. Next slide, please. So this is just to summarize the issues. So there is a scarcity of quality seed material, which we have discussed, and you know the lack of marine special plans. So we have to work with the marine states around it. Financing, insurance is a issue. It's a cyclonic weather can create a problem. So similarly, there are issues in terms of so variety of these things have been discussed, and this kind of a seminar in the next 2 days, some of these issues will be gone in detail. So we'll not get into it. I'll go to the next in terms of government role. The next slide, which just summarizes a little bit in terms of the government's role, the permission to cultivate seaweed, including Capophaga. Now, this is one of the issues which was flagged. It is no longer alien and invasive. It's been in India for the last 4 decades. So how to take it? And initially, we will at least take into areas where there is no issue at all. There are large number. India has a coastline of more than 8,000 kilometers. So there are large areas where it can be taken. So even if there are issues in some places, there is nothing to stop us from taking other places. So the whole idea, what is required is government funding support and handholding for taking up large scale projects, which is what we are doing, and making sure that the applications are there and we take it in a mission mode. That's why we would like to keep on working on it. So with this, I would like to just end it here by the last two slides, which is recent progress and way forward. And this one, last two slides will be covered much more detail by my colleague, Dr. Balaji, who has been spearheading this whole initiative. And there are many issues, and we have gone into quite a lot of depth and worked out strategies which are workable. And that's why I have the confidence that what we are planning, we have the resources, we have the technical manpower, and we have the commitment, and we have the political support at the highest level. And that is why we should be able to move forward. With these words, let me thank the organizers, the ICC. ICC has been really taking it up, the seaweed, in a big way in the last 4 years that I heard of. So I was very happy to be associated today also when they asked that we should do it. Our challenge is to make, to see that whatever we are talking about gets translated in the field. And because there is money at the end of it, so I am not in any doubt that it should be done, as we see what has happened in Indonesia, what has happened in, but if it is in pockets in India, we need to see that it goes in a much bigger area. So I will ask my colleague to expand on these issues in a much more detailed way. So in the special address by Dr. Balaji, he will be covering the detailed consultation that we had on 24th August. And from there, he will cover up some of the gaps in terms of what we are planning and what kind of support the government has lined up. And we are also working with large number of stakeholders. And I'd like to thank ICC for the efforts taken. Thank you.
Dr. Ranjan, thank you. I think it's very, very impressive. And I must say the entire plan and the approach is very, very professional and very, very businesslike. And this gives us tremendous confidence that we are moving in the right direction. And I must also assure you that there are certain hurdles which industry has faced in past. I think if government is quickly able to address some of those, I think this sector will really make a big leap. And with this, may I now request Mr. J. Balaji to please address us.
Thank you, Sri Raju Singh Ji. First, I thank ICC for inviting me. And also, I thank our Secretary, sir, for a very elaborate presentation. Perhaps he has covered the entire thing and very nicely. And I have very little to speak, actually. But I should say that with the lot of, in fact, the last few months, we have been very closely working with in a segregated manner initially. because we wanted to do this. In fact, 2 years ago, we also tried, but we had made no headway. But at the same time, this Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, which is a recent initiative of the government, which has given us a lot of resources. You all will agree, first fundamental thing too is the resource which is required. Then now we are flushed with funds. Funds is not at all a problem. Now the industry and the department and all the stakeholders should have to come together. And the first consultation we have recently held on the 24th, as sir has already said. And we have learned a lot in the process. And it is a continuous process. And we'll also continuously, we are learning. And we are also evolving. And maybe our presentations also will slightly improve or change as we progress, so that the more focused as of today's discussion, tomorrow's discussion also will be very useful to us to set a policy perspective for the sector. Now, having said this, sir has already covered several issues. Just I would like to say that during the last consultations, I could jot down around 18-19 key issues which have been raised by the speakers and the stakeholders. The first fundamental issue was raised was about the quality seed and cultivars. The cultivars, what we have now, is rather quite old and rather it lost its virulence, and there is an urgent need for rolling out. Here, there is a today's tomorrow's discussion should give us a broad roadmap as to how we will get this out fast, because we should have a short-term plan as well as a long-term plan. Maybe 2-3 years we are looking at. Maybe if we can have to import some seed or some program, we are also open to that. Today's meeting and tomorrow we should kindly come out. So it's a low, but we feel that the research has to be a continuous process. It will take time before tangible results come, because the opinion of the industry is that the scaling up is an issue. The scaling up will require time. So, and there is a need for a multiple, regions to take off. It not exactly, we are just located at Mandapam and to some extent on the Gujarat side. Perhaps there is a need for a multiple locations in to take off. And that strategy will enable a broad basing this particular initiative. And also we require here the key role will be played by the state governments. The state governments in their coastal waters, they should have a clarity in their leasing policy. That is one second thing which has come out in the last meeting. A good leasing policy is required, a stable leasing policy is required. Zonation is required to distinguish between, segregate the fishing locations, fishing boat areas, and as well as these seaweed. The social issues has to be addressed. Then we also require a continuous technology infusion and upgradation also. So there is no way we can just depend exclusively on the current technologies. We have to progress beyond that. Then we also have to look at, by midterm, we have to look at a diversified strategy, whether we go within the coastal waters or we'll go into deep ocean. What we have given to understand from the literature is that the deep sea, rather the oceanic seaweed cultivation is also a big thing in some of the countries. This is a thing which we can look at maybe towards a couple of years come from now. And also a land-based cultivation. During the last consultation, some speakers have given us a good ideas as to how we can use the wasteland, which on the adjacent to the ocean, which can be utilized for the seaweed cultivation. And also growing, I have seen some of the papers in the FAO, which also said the aquaculture ponds, we can do a co-cultivation of the seaweed, along with in some during the aquaculture, water channels can be utilized for the monoline cultivation, like the tube net cultivation or whatever the practices are. That is an option we have, because we are a very good aquaculture country. And I was very happy to say that in spite of challenges, the way today Kappafagus is being discussed, Kappafagus, similarly, we have a Vanami shrimp, which is 100% imported shrimp from the broodstock. We are very successful in 10 years. We are the leading shrimp producing exporting country in the world today. So that is in spite of COVID, we have grown by 6-7%. So that is a story. This is all because of the great initiative of the industry and able support of a couple of good policy initiatives by the government. So this is a strategy we also like to have in seaweed. Maybe we have to know the feedback a couple of days from now. We like to have at the end of the meeting as to what sort of, because we felt that government should be a catalytic role and we should be enabling role. And the industry has to be given space wherein it can work. The strategy on our shrimp sector, we like to follow here also. then we are looking at species diversification going beyond tapa ficus. So we shall be in a country, we have to huge area we have, but at the same time there are challenges here, because some of the members in the last meeting was telling us that we are at the R&D, so it's a bench level work or sometimes not even a pilot level works in the other species. So this is one area which required an urgent intervention. Then we are open to establishing seaweed parks. You know, you might have noticed in our Pradhan Mantri Matsya Sampada Yojana, it's a 3 billion scheme. Because we have here some international speakers, so that's what I like to tell the figures in dollars also. It's a $3 billion initiative of our government for next 5 years. Within that, we have almost $100 million to establish the eco parks. So some of this money can be utilized for even the seaweed parks. That the members also told us that Gujarat and Tamil Nadu can be an ideal location for establishing seaweed parks. Then the value addition is the key. The entire thing, even today, shrimp sector, we also face the same challenge. 10 years down the line, we have initially concentrated on production. The idea was to just to produce. But today, the shrimp market in next 5 years is saturating. The demand, there is an issue gradually. So you have to go for value addition. Unless you do not go for value addition, the returns are low. There'll be competition. In the similar, what I am given to understand, it's a very competitive industry as far as seaweed also, like the Southeastern countries have done extremely well. We are in a very competitive environment. Therefore, we have to look at value addition. In fact, we have a huge consumer base in the country itself, and we have traditional history of Ayurvedic medicines and all that also there. So we have to look at our own markets also. So that is one area which I think the industry should help us. How to grow within the country, that is the challenge. Because we have almost a huge urban middle class, and diverse food habits are also coming up. So marketing infrastructure we can create under a Matsya Sampada Yojana. So we like to support startups which want to come forward, and incubation of the technologies also we like to support. In fact, we want private sector to take the lead here. We do not want much to do in government here. Suppose for example, startups, we easily give around 50 lakh rupees for each startup. If they come up with a small with a project, they can use for startups can come forward. We can give assistance to them, and we can give up to 3 crores almost to the incubation centers. If they want to establish an incubation center, that will be quite useful So the promotion of the investments also we are looking at. Today's tomorrow meeting should come back for the investments. What sort of investment we have in aquaculture, 100% FDI. But we like to also look at this as a seaweed as a possible options. This is one thing we look at that we are working on, and we want good investments. The industry should come and give us some guidance as to how to go about. Then we also look at, as Secretary Sir has already discussed, the convergence. And we find the Andamans and the Lakshadweep are the huge areas where we have a lot of opportunity. Lakshadweep is a good seed center which we can develop. That's our consultation has shown us. Then we can also look at edible options of the seaweed. And the most important is the traceability and the standards. The traceability and the standards issues are very important for seaweed. We have to be non-tariff barriers have increased. Everywhere the phytosanitary measures, this has to be taken care of. We are looking at that. And the import substitution. Today, one of the industry was telling around 3,000 crore value of biostimulants are being imported to India. Maybe we have to look at import substitution at the earliest. Then, and large-scale youth participation for giving employment. This is an area which is almost close to our initiative. I think we can definitely the youth can have a huge role here. And we have a very conservative targets of around 1 million tons. But the industry said that the 1 million ton is achievable, and there have been already working. We started our work, and we looked at definitely already Secretary Sir has given the roadmap. I don't want to dwell in that. But if at all anything today speakers would like to ask us as to we can also clarify. There is one more technology is called seaweed, and the sea cage cultivation is an initiative, joint initiative, also one area which can look at for the improvement of the biomass. So there are funds is not an issue, we said, what sort of incentives industry will require. We look at, we have to look at the low hanging fruits so that we can carry forward our mission. And we are really, even though we didn't declare ourselves as a mission, but we are working on a mission mode on this. And I think today, next 2 days, initiate our understanding will be very useful for us to better formulate our policy documents and also our targeting. The funds is not an, as I said, we have new schemes. We have a 20,000 crore, 3 billion this scheme. We have an FIDF scheme also where initiatives can be taken for the CV. States are also taking their own initiative. They are also coming forward for their own funds also. And the industry definitely can participate. And we know, we have seen in our sector, if a government spend, public spending, a rupee public spending, there is almost 2-3 times, the private sector also participate. And we can see that in case in seaweed, we can ideally, theoretically, we have done some calculations, some small max has shown that we can easily achieve, with the governmental spending itself, direct spending itself, with the 3,280 crore around industry, we can grow in 5 years. And if the private sector also chips in, it can grow up to 10,000 crore industry. So with these few words, I think I thank ICC for taking this initiative, and I'll be more happy to make it more interactive so that if anybody would like to ask us, I can be in a position to answer. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Balaji. I think, again, a lot of focused approach in terms of issues, options, markets, role of industry, technology, startups, availability of funds. So I think all this is really going to make things happen. And I'm sure the industry, along with the government, would rise up to the challenge, and we will do our bit. Our next speaker is Dr. G.S. Samiran. And we all have heard the excellent work Tamil Nadu government has done. And I think in the seaweed space, Tamil Nadu definitely has done a lot. And I think you will also be leading, many of the initiatives. So, and ICC has been fortunate enough to partner with you. So with this, may I request Dr. Samiran to please address us.
Thank you, Mr. Rajiv Singh. At the outset, I would like to thank ICC for organizing such a good forum for discussing post-COVID scenario on seaweed cultivation and the challenges in this sector. First of all, I want to thank respected Secretary Fisheries, Government of India, and Joint Secretary Sir for a wonderful presentation which put the things in perspective. So I would mainly dwell upon the Tamil Nadu scenario. Hope my content is visible.
No, sir. Please share it.
Once again. Now it is visible. Is it visible now?
Sir, go to, it's perfectly visible.
Thank you. This is the global scenario versus our country scenario of seaweed industry, where it's a $6 billion USD industry in global level, at global level. When we see the Indian context, only 10% of the seaweed is being cultivated. 90%, over 90% is collected naturally, compared to 97% of cultured seaweed in the global market. So a major shift in this regard is impending, and our policy of union government and the government of Tamil Nadu is in this direction, so much so that the cultured seaweed should be taking up the major lion's share in the coming years. These are the utilities of the seaweed market, mainly for human consumption. Equally important in other industries like pharmaceutical, nutraceutical, and confectionery and cosmetic industries. if you see from the chart, it's very clear that the natural collection of native species is declining, because it's a cumbersome process, it's a time consuming process, not a fine tuned way of collection. And the economy realization in this wild collection is far poorer than culturing of the seaweed. Coming to the mariculture policy of our government, very clear that the mariculture policy is towards better and sustainable production of aquaculture and mariculture, and the fish production includes seaweed production also. And this definition has come from Government of India of late, and this has given more thrust on seaweed culture through mariculture. Previously, it was not well defined because it was not considered as a mariculture product. And the present mariculture and national marine fisheries policy has very clearly defined seaweed as a potential mariculture product. Little bit on the vision of the state government on the state government of Tamil Nadu on mariculture and particularly on seaweed. We are looking at improved and increased production of seaweed through cultivation and shifting from wild collection towards culture, and making maximum and sustainable use of our coastal waters, which is conducive for this activity, especially in the Parkway region and in Gulf of Mannar region, and promoting this particular activity as an alternative livelihood for the fisherwomen of these coastal districts. We are equally promoting the industries wherein which an ecosystem can be developed in this part of south of India, so that the industries also can flourish through this activity. These are the major areas where we are concentrating in the Park Bay side, and of course in the Gulf of Mannar side. Park Bay side of Tamil Nadu, mostly we are concentrating the capophagus cultivation. We have almost 21 villages who are dedicated in the Park Bay side, and equally 20 number of villages in Ramnathapuram who are mainly concentrating on Gelidella and Gracilaria species. So these are the natural sites where natural collection happens in the Gulf of Mannar sites. There are certain constraints because it falls in the biosphere reserve, protected area under the Forest Act. So wild collection happens here. Cultivation and culture constraints are in the Gulf of Mannar side. These are certain policy level initiatives the government has been taking of the past decade, basically on supporting the women who are into seaweed culture by giving them subsidies, giving them credit, financial support through banks, and also providing them opportunity and exposure visits. Of late, our fisherwoman team were active participants in the Indian International Seaweed Summit, which happened in Mumbai in 2019, and also in at Chennai in 2020. Under major programs of Government of India and through a World Bank program, we have concentrated on the human resource development in this sector by giving them training and also handholding them by giving capital subsidies. These are certain projects through which government has helped them, but if you see, it's all in a very limited fashion, not in a major way. And now we are very thankful to the Prime Minister's Matsya Sampada Yojana, where in which Government of India is envisaging a revolution in this sector, so that these smaller subsidies, rather than the smaller subsidies, Government of India is envisaging a creating a greater ecosystem, a bigger ecosystem in this sector, which will definitely help in expansion of all these activities, and also at the end of the day, it will benefit the fisherwoman of this area. So certain photos of the activities happening in this area. We have two types of culture activities happening. Monoline culture, which is predominantly in districts of Pudukote, Tanjavur, the Tiruvarur side, and raft culture in Ramnathapuram side. Last year, through a World Bank project, we have started value addition of this product, and we have made joint liability groups within the fisherwomen who are into these activities. Roughly 1,500 women are directly involved with this activity, and we have federated them, and now they are producing a value-added product, which is SAP, and they are selling the value-added product to the industry, which is realizing better income for them. But this is also in a very small fashion. Only one unit we have started. We are planning to start multiple units, like 5 units through state support. This year, 5 more units will come. Under PMMSY, we are planning to broad-base it much more. As rightly pointed out by the Joint Secretary Sir and Secretary Sir, there is need for expansion. Now we are concentrating only on certain species and on for certain demand. These need to be broad-based, and the species diversification should happen. And it is impending that only if species diversification happens through technology infusion, this would be a sustainable. There will be a sustainable growth. And broad basing geographically, because now only around 293 kilometers of Park Bay is concentrating on this particular activity. But if we do a good survey and mapping, definitely there are shallow and calm pockets in the entire coastline, because Tamil Nadu has an excellent coastline of 1,000 plus kilometers. Out of that, only 250 to 260 kilometers are being utilized for this particular culture. We should be thinking in bigger terms after a proper mapping. For the country also, the same would apply, because presently Gujarat and Tamil Nadu are two states going towards culture activities. Other states also have bays and better geographically suitable and conducive environment. These need to be mapped so that industry also gets around the season availability of material. That is a major challenge industry is facing now. They have raised it in different forums. Last week also we had an excellent interaction with all the industry players who have signed the MOUs with us with the state government during the Indian International Seaweed Summit. Happened last January. We had excellent meeting with the industry partners. Around 8 MOUs were signed for a tune of around 50 plus crore. And the government is constantly following it up with these industry players. They are all coming positively forward. They are all happy to see the policy level changes at union and state level, and they are happy to invest and become growth partners in this sector. These are certain constraints which was already discussed by Joint Secretary Sir during his talk. One is species, the quality of the seed material available. The commercially scaled up species is Kapaf acres, and Kapaf acres virulence have declined over years. There need to be either increased virulence species or import of better quality of the same species. Same pure line stock should be imported. So that is one major demand from the industry. At the same time, lack of processing industries to consume the so. A challenge the cultivators are facing, the women are facing, and the climate resilient spores and shoots should be developed, and for this great amount of technology infusion should happen, and we are hopeful that CSMCRI is working in this regard. I should thank Dr. Kannan, who is the present director of CSMCRI. He has been personally involved in all these activities, and he has handholded the department over last 2-3 years in an excellent fashion, so that this has realized to the field. Previously, it was remaining in the labs. With the intervention of our scientists from CSIR institutes, it has been pushed to the field, and it has been realized. So I thank CSMCRI, and I hope continued support from the institute in the coming years also, because we are looking at greater investment in this sector in the this year onwards through PMMSY. Our secretary sir has rightly mentioned that rather than rhetoric and policy jargons, this year Government of India has properly allocated 640 crores for this particular activity alone, and government is expecting another 1000 crores from the private sector. This is a very welcome step to the industries, because in the last industry meet happened last week, all the industry partners were very happy to see this concrete step from Government of India, and they are very hopeful that they can also invest in this sector and expect better returns from it. And the PMMSY has allocated certain activities to commercially expand this cultivation and create all the linkages, the forward and backward linkages in this sector. So from the government side, we have pushed proposals worth more than 50 crores in the first phase, and expecting another 150 crores from the industry side, so that around 200 crores of investment we are hoping in the next 2 years itself. We are trying to push from government investment and equivalent or more investment from the private side. As rightly pointed out by Union Secretary sir in his presentation, FFPOs we are going to create in this sector, and FFPOs would be encouraged and empowered to do marketing and create all linkages so that they will realize better value for their product. We are also hoping the Kisan credit card system of Government of India, just announced in 2018 budget by Honorable Prime Minister, would also help in boosting the sector by infusing some credit, formal credit into the sector. In the state level technical committee, this was accepted as one allowed practice under fishery sector, and the SLBC, the state level bankers committee, have endorsed it. Now we are sending applications to different banks. And banks are also proactive to extend the credit to the fisherwomen who are doing it. So this is the ecosystem we are envisaging, where government plays a major role in policy interventions and also handholding. Seaweed growers with better credit facilities from bank would broad-base and expand their area of cultivation, and the major partner is the industry, who would invest for consuming this produce and invest in capital intensive projects like nursery, processing units and all. So this is the context of Tamil Nadu, where we are inviting industry partners to join hands with government and improve or take advantage of this situation, where we have a good and conducive coastline. Already we are pioneers in seaweed cultivation. With the introduction of PMMSY and infusion of public funding from government side, equal and more investment from private sector is expected. We have central institute like CSMCRI, who has been pioneering in the research of seaweed culture. They are located in Tamil Nadu in Mandapam. We have the support from CMFRI, who is also equally capable and competent to do research in this regard. They are also, they have done statistical studies and certain diversification studies in this regard. So these two central institutions would be technology partners, and we have a legislative backup for these activities, where Tamil Nadu is the first state to launch Tamil Nadu Contract Farming Act, the Agriculture Produce and Livestock Contract Farming and Services Act of 2019, in line with the Government of India's policy. Actually, ahead of the policy, Government of Tamil Nadu has launched this and implemented this act. We have a Business Facilitation Act of Tamil Nadu, which ensures single window clearances for all industry partners. So we have a good legislative backup, policy framework, and geographical conducivity, so that industries should be forthcoming in this to invest in this sector. As I rightly discussed in the previous slides, these are the expectations from the industries. Certain policy interventions they have requested, like zonation, allocation of land, and all these things we have taken up with the government, and it is actively being considered at the highest level. So with this, I would wind up my presentation, and once again thank ICC, who is constantly gearing up for this particular sector. For the last 3 years, we are associating closely, and the last two India International Seaweed Summits, these things were thoroughly discussed, and finally it has resulted in a policy level intervention from Government of India. We are thankful for ICC's intervention. We hope more industries will come forward and invest, so that this particular activity will come forward in this regard, and thank you ICC once again for this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you everybody.
Thank you.
I think we had a very wonderful enlightening session over the last 1 hour, and I wish to thank each of our esteemed guests for sharing their vision and insights. I am sure today's session will sow the seeds for the best possible for the seaweed sector, and I now request to kindly do the honors of felicitating Dr. E.K. Swaran for lifetime research in seaweed, and give the vote of thanks. Over to
Thank you. I think Tamil Nadu, as we have just heard, has done tremendous work, and they have also highlighted and added one more dimension to this, that is women empowerment. I remember when we were there, Honorable Minister of Fisheries and the entire department, the kind of engagement women have with this sector. So that also goes well with the government's priorities, and it also adds to the quality of life and the livelihood. I think we have heard some very good comments, and Dr. Eeswaran, I would once again like to acknowledge his tremendous work in the field of seaweed. And with this, I would like to formally thank our chief doctor for taking so much of interest and having a very, very business-like plan for the development of seaweeds. I would also like to thank Mr. J. Balaji for his keenness to engage, to work on the issues which are facing the seaweed sector and which are becoming impediments for its growth, and I'm sure we'll be able to address those together. I would also like to thank Dr. S. Kannan our partner for last now almost 4 years. I think they are doing tremendous work in the R&D space, and going ahead, I think they will definitely be playing a very important role. So we are thankful to you. And last but not least, I would like to also thank Senior Vice President of ICC. And over these 2 days, I'm sure we will come up with plenty of good ideas and thoughts. ICC team will compile all the suggestions and ideas, and we will come up with a brief action plan based on the ideas, and share it with Dr. Ranjan and also with Mr. Balaji. With this, I again express a hearty thanks to all of you. Thank you. We will now be moving to our next session. I can see Mr. Abhiram said there. So welcome to you. And I would also like to invite Dr. Vaibhav Mantri, who is the principal scientist of CSN PRI. I would also like to request Dr. B. Johnson, who is again a scientist at CMFRI at Mandapam, and Mr. Abhiram Sheth to please start the next session. May I request my colleague Tapan to please take over from now on?
Yeah.
Over to Tapan.
Thank you very much, sir. Now we are slightly behind schedule, so I am requesting Dr. Vaibhav Mantri, the principal scientist, CSIR, CSMCRI, and he will give the presentation on agarothite's trade in India, the status of government, and the way forward. Dr. Vaibhav Mantri.
Yeah, thank you very much. And I just wanted to say that 1 minute, let me share my screen. My title of the presentation is not government, but it is Agarophyte Trade in India, Status of Farming and Way Forward. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah, it is visible.
Yes, it is.
Yeah. Thank you so much. And let me thank Mr. Vikas Agarwal, Senior Vice President ICC, my own director, Dr. Srinivas Kannan, then Dr. Rajiv Ranjan, Secretary of Ministry of Fisheries, Government of India, Dr. Balaji, Joint Secretary, Ministry of Fisheries, Government of India, Dr. Samiran, Director of Fisheries, Tamil Nadu Fisheries Department, and Dr. Rajiv Singh of ICC, and of course, Mr. Tapan, with whom we have been working for last 3 years, to give me this opportunity. As you all know, that since last complete session, we have been hearing that we are talking about Kappa ficus cultivation. And we need to diversify, and also like, although Kappa ficus is an anchoring species, and whatever cultivation has happened in India, it has successful because of Kappa ficus, but still we have our own indigenous species, and I will be basically talking about their prospects of their cultivation and what are the issues basically which we have to, you know, remove. Just to give you global status, as we have heard from Rajiv sir, that this commercial cultivation today is about 32 million metric tons per year, of which around 95% to 97% accounts for farming, and its value is about $12 billion. This is what FAO report, recent FAO report says. And when you see the composition, the most of the cultivated part comes because of one group called Kappa ficus and Eukema. Basically, just for your knowledge, that Kappa ficus and Eukema were basically categorized into one genus called Eukema. It was later Doughty showed that since it produces kappa carrageenan, the new genus was established. So these two together form the major cultivated species, followed by Laminaria japonica, and then Gracilaria, and then Undaria and Porphyria and others. So when we see about Indian scenario, we have to, although it's very historic but interesting perspective to see that Agarophyte report was, when all kind of expeditions were happening in 1857 to 1900, there were five major expeditions. And the Challenger expedition, which was basically promoted by Charles Thomson of University of Edinburgh, reported some of the Gracilaria species from Indian Ocean region, of course from some of the coastal regions of India. And European phycologists were the first one to basically document this flora and the diversity of Indian species. But it is very interesting also to note that exactly after 3 days, we'll be completing 50 years that legendary phycologists of our country, Dr. Mrs. T.V., Professor Krishnamurti, and Dr. K.R. Menon, they form a group and they named it Seaweed Research Utilization Association of India. It was born in Marainalga Research Station of Mandapam, at Mandapam, and they basically mooted the idea that indigenous agarophyte should be cultivated. There was no much interest in carrageenophyte then, and all the agarophytes, they thought of utilizing it, and creating livelihood. And it was a very interesting fact was told to me by Professor Krishnamurti when he was alive. He said that when he moved to Mandapam from Bhavnagar, he along with his colleagues at CMFRI established landing centers, and first priority our institute under the guidance of Professor Krishnamurti did was survey of economically important seaweeds. And this was again the national priority then. And between 1961 to 1991, there were five major surveys, and they covering almost all the coastal states except West Bengal, and I think, except West Bengal, including Andaman excluding Andaman and West Bengal, and including Lakshadweep and all other coastal states. And they have basically enumerated what are the species available, which are agarophyte, algenophyte, carrageenophyte, and you can see that several agarophytes were reported, and Gelidiella and Gracilaria were the dominant species. As I said, that there are several landing centers. You can see here the picture. This is one of the landing center near Mandapam called Vedalaya. This is the stretch between Dhanushakodi to Kanyakumari, and more specifically in the Ramanathapuram district. This is around 300 kilometer stretch, and this is called seaweed belt. And collection happens throughout the year depending on the dominance of the species, like agarophyte and algenophytes were collected from islands of Gulf of Mannar. And there are 14 landing centers. I need not have to read them. And about 200 fisherwomen, they basically are involved in collection of seaweeds. I have shown you 5 decades of landing data, and you can see that it is very fluctuating. But if you see last 20 years, it's drastically declining. My colleague Dr. Ganeshan has published a paper on agarophytes of India, and it was very prominently shown. And also Samiran sir also told that this Gelidiella and Gracilaria edilis, these are commercially harvested species, they are declining because of more pressure on natural resources. This is the indigenous agar production data, thanks to Madurai Agar Association and Marine Chemicals Cochin. You can see that there are two types of agar India produces. One is food grade agar, and second one is bacteriological grade agar. Mrs. Thivi, way back in 70s, proposed that India's potential is around 300 metric tons. She has proposed 50 years back, and we have reached that figure only in 2014-15. So the food grade agar of 300 metric ton was produced, and our production is still between 200 to 300 metric tons in case of food grade, and around 80 to 90 tons of bacteriological grade agar. And as I said, these are the leading. Madurai Agar and Alginate Manufacturing Association is a conglomeration of different small MSME industries. And the biggest industry is Marine Chemicals Cochin. They produce this. But the biggest problem with this is natural harvesting is declining. And that is why many of these industries, at least I know Marine Cochin, Marine Chemicals Cochin, they import a lot of agarophyte dry biomass for processing. This is, I tried to get some import-export data. Although the more authentic would have been MPDA, but we could not get it. And just to show you, this is the last 10 years trend, that here also it is fluctuating, but good part is we are slowly importing whatever little quantity agar we are producing, our import is showing progress. But export and also export is showing declining. And there is around 3,000 metric tons of agar we have imported, which is worth about 56 million US dollar. And we have imported it from 30 different countries, while we exported to around 103 different countries at the tune of 1,500 metric tons worth around 25 million US dollars. And this trend is basically for 2018. I could not get data for 2019. Here also, basically, you can say see the same scenario. And here I have given the figures. I don't have to read them. When you see about agarophyte, there is lot of variation.